hainbat aldaketa daude aurreko ekitaldiekiko. Iraupena egun bakar batera mugatu da, eta gai Big Data arlo estadistikotik haratagokoa da. Hoy damos comienzo a la 29ª edición del Seminario Internacional de Estadística, que este año tiene un especial significado para Eustat, ya que celebramos nuestro 30 aniversario. Es por este motivo que hemos querido hacer algunos cambios en relación a ediciones anteriores, por un lado en la duración, que se ha limitado a una jornada, y por otro en cuanto a la temática, que en esta ocasión ha ido más allá del propio ámbito estadístico al tratar el fenómeno del Big Data. Los cambios realizados en este seminario han tenido una finalidad muy clara, el celebrar junto al mayor número de vosotros y vosotras posible la trayectoria de este instituto en estos 30 años. Por lo tanto, estoy obligada en esta inauguración a destacar la importancia de Eustat en estos años. Durante la última parte del pasado siglo, la estadística se convirtió definitivamente en una herramienta necesaria para el desarrollo de las sociedades modernas. Y hoy en día, la estadística oficial fiable es uno de los pilares de la democracia. La información se ha convertido en el elemento central de la toma de decisiones y, como consecuencia, hemos asistido a una creciente demanda de información estadística. Ningún gobierno del mundo podría planificar, ni desplegar, ni mucho menos evaluar una acción de gobierno si no se soportara en un sistema estadístico fiable. Todo esto se tuvo muy en cuenta en el nacimiento de la estadística oficial de la Comunidad Autónoma de Euskadi allá por los años 80, cuando el Gobierno vasco crea la Dirección de Estadística, cuando promueve la aprobación en el Parlamento de la Ley Estadística Vasca en el 23 de abril de 1986, primera en el Estado, y cuando constituye Eustat en noviembre de ese mismo año. Así pues, se puede afirmar que el Gobierno vasco desde sus inicios entendió la importancia de una actividad estadística oficial fuerte y apostó por su impulso y desarrollo. En cuanto a lo que ha supuesto esta actividad de Eustat en estos 30 años, podemos destacar algunos de sus principales logros. Organizar y poner en marcha el sistema estadístico vasco, de la que forman parte a través de la Comisión y del Consejo de Estadística, productores y usuarios de la estadística, administración autonómica, foral y municipal, universidad y agentes sociales, y cuya finalidad principal es la de plantear las necesidades en materia estadística de la Comunidad Autónoma de Euskadi para que sean recogidos a través de planes y programas estadísticos que son aprobados en el Parlamento Vasco. En estos 30 años se ha configurado un entramado productivo, integrado, propio y de calidad para dar respuesta a las necesidades estadísticas planteadas en los diferentes planes. Así pues, las más de 128 operaciones estadísticas del plan actual 2014-2017 se integran en alguno de los siguientes sistemas estadísticos: sistema de estadísticas sociodemográficas, sistema de estadísticas económicas, contabilidad nacional y marco input-output, sistema y sistema territorial y GIS. De igual manera, este entramado productivo ha evolucionado considerablemente en estos años, adaptándose a los cambios acontecidos en nuestra sociedad, donde se ha cambiado la forma de producir estadísticas y difundirlas, incluso el modo de recoger la información. Este es el caso de la transformación tecnológica surgida en estas últimas décadas, que han marcado sustancialmente el proceso productivo de Eustat, así como el de su difusión. Otro logro ha sido responder a los principios fundamentales de las actividades estadísticas proclamados por la Organización Nacional de Naciones Unidas, como son la independencia, relevancia, credibilidad y confidencialidad de los datos, así como producir información estadística en base a los factores de calidad que se establece desde Eurostat. En este sentido, destacar dos de las preocupaciones que vertebran el día a día de cualquiera de los y las que trabajamos en Eustat, como es cumplir el calendario de publicación de las estadísticas y proteger el secreto estadístico de los datos facilitados por los informantes. Estas máximas, junto al resto de aspectos de calidad, han ido perfilándose y evolucionando en estos 30 años. No obstante, en esta celebración no podemos quedarnos solo haciendo un balance de los logros alcanzados en este periodo, sino que es obligado el mirar hacia el futuro, donde se presentan grandes retos en la sociedad cambiante y globalizada en la que nos encontramos. Estos retos para la estadística europea se resumen en la denominada Visión 2020 del Sistema Estadístico Europeo y que entre las 5 áreas estratégicas que destaca se encuentra la denominada Nuevas Fuentes de Datos, donde se remarca la necesidad de explorar la potencialidad del Big Data en la producción estadística. Con este propósito, Eustat comenzó en 2015 un proyecto de investigación de Big Data en la estadística oficial junto a la Facultad de Informática de la Universidad del País Vasco, del cual se dará amplia cuenta en la sesión de esta tarde, sesión que conducirá Ángeles Iztueta aquí presente. La jornada de hoy es un paso más en la línea de trabajo que para ello hemos querido contar con un prestigioso experto en la utilización del Big Data en el ámbito de la estadística oficial, como es Peter Strauss. Peter Strauss es coordinador del programa Big Data de Statistics Netherlands. Actualmente coordina el grupo de Big Data del proyecto europeo promovido por Eurostat y es miembro de la Global Working Group on Big Data para Estadísticas Oficiales de Naciones Unidas. Antes de dedicarse a Big Data, Peter fue responsable de Open Data en Statistics Netherlands, ocupó durante muchos años el cargo de jefe de unidad de desarrollo de procesos y gestión de la calidad y previamente trabajó en Eurostat y es miembro electo del Instituto Internacional de Estadística. Para Eustat es todo un honor el poder contar con un experto como Peter Strauss en la jornada de hoy. Igualmente, quiero agradecer en nombre de Eustat la participación de los ponentes de la tarde. Agradecer a la Agencia Vasca de Protección de Datos, ya que nos ayudará a clarificar un tema esencial como es la confidencialidad de los datos en el tratamiento del Big Data. Agradecer también a los participantes de la Facultad de Informática de la Universidad del País Vasco su buen hacer durante toda la colaboración mantenida y, como no, a los técnicos de Eustat por su dedicación y competencia en dicho proyecto. Azkenik, denoi eskertu nahi dizuet bertaratzea. Pozpozi gaude ikusirik zein ugari agertu zareten unibertsitate, administrazioi publiko, enpresa pribatu, elkarte eta estadistika institututatik. Benetan, espero dugu ikastaroak haseagarri izan dakizuela. Por último, agradeceros a todos y a todas vuestra asistencia. Nos complace enormemente la respuesta obtenida y el poder tener hoy aquí un número tan nutrido de profesionales procedentes de ámbitos tan dispersos como la universidad, la administración pública, la empresa privada, asociaciones e institutos de estadística. Esperamos sinceramente que este curso cumpla con todas vuestras expectativas. Finally, I'd like to thank very much to Professor Strauss. You can take part in this meeting, and we hope to enjoy your visits in the Basque Country.
Thank you, Christina, for your nice words. Ladies and gentlemen, kaixo egunon, buenos dias, good morning to all of you. I feel very honored to be invited to this occasion and to tell you something about what I know of big data. It's also a pleasure to be here. Yesterday I had the chance to see Victorio Gasteiz, and I liked it very much. I was impressed by its charm, even though it rained, and so I could imagine how it looks like when the sun is shining. So today I will talk about big data and official statistics. Now, as you all know, the amount of data that's being generated nowadays in society is increasing, is ever increasing, and the use of devices is ever increasing. And this means that for many institutions, for many actors in society, this has consequences. It is, of course, very important for government, for policy purposes. It's important to businesses themselves. It's important to research institutions. And last but not least, it's important to national statistical institutes, and I should add regional statistical institutes as well, and even local statistical institutes, because many cities also have statistical departments. And we are cooperating with them in the Netherlands as well. We have big data centers for at the city level. And so this is important to all of us, but it's especially important to statistics because working with data is our core business. And so many government organizations turn to us to help them with big data especially. And this is something that is a kind of a new demand on us. It is a challenge, but it's also an opportunity. And I hope to make you more familiar with this, with the developments in big data today. And I also hope that I make the subject a little bit more accessible to you. As I understand, you've got a workbook, and there are many references in that workbook. So I won't give too many references in my talk today, but you will find them in the book. So what will I talk about today? We've got a session before coffee break and a session afterwards. So I divide what I'm telling you in two parts. The first part starts with a general introduction on what actually is big data, and then especially in the context of official statistics. Then I will talk about the international dimension of big data. And there have been developed guidelines and other helps at the international level. And they really picked it up at all levels of the of international organizations. So I'll try to explain what's going on there. And then before the coffee break, I will give a couple of examples. And I will use my experience from Statistics Netherlands for these examples. I'll give an example of the use of road sensor data, of mobile phone data, and of social media data. There are, of course, many more examples that that I could give, and many other institutes are also working with big data. And but I have to focus a little bit because that gives me the opportunity also to give to go a little bit more into depth with these examples. I know you have different backgrounds, and I'll try to give something to all of you. But I also know there are many statisticians in here, and they would like to know a little bit more about how actually do you work with big data. So that's behind these three examples. I will not give the solution to all the issues that we encounter. I will mention the issues with the examples, but after lunch, after coffee break, there will be an opportunity to look at the issues one by one. And so then I will start with saying something about the what is new in the approach to big data associated to the issues that we've seen. Then I go into the to how to organize a process, what is involved in processing big data and its methodology and its IT. Then I will go into matters of access and partnerships. And the reason that it's so prominent in my talk is that getting access to big data is a condition to work with big data. It goes without saying, but still, it is now turning out to be a real bottleneck for working with big data that we need first to get access to that data. So, especially international, there's been initiatives to promote access and to get agreements and to with data providers to start partnerships with them. So I will talk about that as well. And then towards the end, I will broaden the talk to give more perspective on strategic aspects, because we are working in a changing context. So we have to think what our position should be in that changing context and in the longer term. And also how to organize ourselves in the statistical offices to deal with big data. And then, if time allows, I will give you a couple of more examples what's going on with big data in the world, other institutes, and then finally I have a conclusion. What you may see that I have not addressed in the structure of this, the issue of privacy, but I will touch upon it once in a while, and also there's a separate session on on privacy this afternoon, and so I thought I should not treat that aspect in depth, and I will have the opportunity then to react, I think, to speakers, so if you have any questions, there will also be an opportunity to talk about that later. The same goes for the subject of web scraping, in which we are also active in the Netherlands, but there's also a session on that later today, so we'll wait for that. Concerning questions from your side, I would really appreciate if you have questions and think of questions to pose later while I'm talking. And so we have half an hour for questions and I hope also answers. At the end of the second part of this presentation. So let's start with the first part. What is big data? This is something that is a difficult question, and let us not talk an hour about this, but still I would like to make a couple of remarks and also make clear what is the notion of big data that we use in official statistics. Now, big data is actually something that existed before it became a hype. Especially in physics, think about CERN in Geneva, and in astronomy, huge amounts of data were being processed already. And before it became a hype, it became a hype actually about 3 years ago. Then it passed, with Google Trends, it passed the term open data as more popular, being more used. And so it became a hype, but even before that, in our statistics office, we used already scanner data and we did already web scraping. And so it's just a new term. And then the question becomes, of course, because there's a hype, do we have to follow that hype? Now, I will try to explain that this hype really is a game changer for our offices, actually for society, I think. And so when it started, there was a book by Meyer Schoenberger and Cookier of The Economist, who wrote a book on big data, an introduction, and I can recommend that introduction. And it's now already a classic, a classical book. It's been translated into Spanish. I'm not sure, but I think not in Basque language, but okay, it's already translated in many languages, so I just recommend it. It gives a general introduction in case you you're looking for that. Now, there have been proposed many definitions, and these definitions have at least three feasts in common: for volume, for velocity, and for variety. And so the notion of big data came into being because of the observation that we get data sources, we get data with huge volume, with quite a high speed and frequency, sometimes continuously, and which is quite often not structured. It's high variety. And then some people added one, two, or three fees to that, such as veracity. But there have been many definitions around. So what we did in statistics in 2013, actually the United Nations Economic Commission for Europe, the UNECE, was the first international organization to really target this issue of big data and try to define it. And so a group was formed and that came up with a definition. And it is this definition: big data are data sources that can be generally described as high volume, velocity, and variety of data that demand cost-effective, innovative forms of processing for enhanced insight and decision-making. Now, this is a mouthful, but the main thing is that this is about new data sources. And as Christina mentioned, this is one of the challenges for 2020 and beyond. It will ever be a challenge to statistical offices. I hope so. Anyway, that makes life interesting for statisticians. Now we have a definition, but I should admit that this is a rather fake definition. It has the word generally in it. And also, there are a couple of problems associated with this. So do high volume, velocity, and variety all have to occur together? Maybe not. You could have only high volume and then call it big data without having a very high velocity, for instance. Or you could have a huge amount of data, which is actually quite structured. It's not so, the variety is not so so high. So it's not as clear-cut as it may seem. And also there's always a definition, or there's always a question, whether administrative data sources are included in the notion of big data. And I think it is. I think it is, but only very few administrative data sources. And in that case, they should at least be high volume. And we'll see a couple of examples. The reason why it's also you could consider some of these data, big data from government administrations, is that they make use sometimes of sensors or new data sources themselves. We'll see an example of that as well. So this is now a definition, and the proof of the pudding is in the eating. And so let's see how this definition is actually applied and what data sources are actually included in practice. One way to look at big data is just to look at its characteristics and to see what is commonly seen when working with big data. And then, of course, we have these three V's: volume, velocity, and variety. That's in the definition itself. But it has more characteristics that you see not with all big data sources, but with many. Quite often, data is unstructured, such as social media data. there is a matter of selectivity. That is, what you get goes through a filter, depends on, for instance, with mobile phone, on the antenna grid that is available. Then there's an issue of population dynamics. For instance, with social media, you see that you can observe that the population is changing very rapidly of those people who use specific social media. Quite often, you do not get data on a level of a phenomenon, but rather on the changes therein, event data. It's quite often organic data in the sense that it is generated by as a by-process of some business or some other organization, and quite often it is also distributed. It is not collected at one single point for some data sources, and that is something that is requires a different approach than having all the data available from one single source. An example is data collected by cities on, for instance, safety security. And if we want to use those data as statistical officers, we have to deal with this diversity. So these are some big data characteristics. You could also look at the use of big data. And in their use, as we've seen in the definition already, it may have consequences for processing, and in that sense, big data may have different consequences than the use of more traditional data sources. But on the other hand, it gives opportunities. Big data gives opportunities. It provides opportunities for instance, new types of data. I'll come back to that in a moment. Let's just give a few examples of big data sources. These three examples I'll give are about road sensor data, on mobile phone location data, CDR records, on public social media messages, only the public ones, so like Twitter messages, on other examples of sources are websites. As you know, we'll see web scraping, for instance. That's then, of course, internet. Google Trends is an example that we can use. We've investigated that in our office. Then we found out that it's very difficult to really make use of this source, but still it has a high potential. Satellite information, we don't use that in our office. Satellite information is used by other offices, and it's actually one of the two or three big data sources that are also being used now in developing countries. So it's a worldwide phenomenon. There are many more sources. When I come to talk about the international side, I will show you a classification of those sources. So it's nice to talk about big data and what's going on, but we have to keep in mind why we need this data, why we want this data, what are the opportunities. It's also very important with new developments to think in terms of opportunities and not to think too much in terms of obstacles. Otherwise, you lose to competition. And if you want to stay at the frontier of developments, then you really have to think in terms of opportunities. And there are many with big data. So there's obviously the possibility of new statistics, that is the description of phenomena that have not been described earlier in statistics, just because we have new types of information. And for instance, mobility you can look at mobile phone data. And you have many more possibilities than you used to have for new statistics. But the statistics that you have can be enhanced by using big data, because sometimes you use a survey, you use based on a sample, and this sample does not allow you to give a detailed breakdown according to certain classifications, to region or in time. So you only get monthly or annual data, and you want to get the data at a weekly basis. Now, if you have a big data source that is very closely correlated to your regular statistics, then you may give estimates for the points in between two publications of the official statistics. So more detailed statistics, more timely statistics is also a possibility if your big data source allows you to make an estimation of the phenomenon you are interested in before you've had a chance to do the data collection by survey, by questionnaire, then you can have a big gain. And especially for business cycle statistics, this is important. Statisticians don't always realize that for certain business cycle data, the value of the information is really dependent on the moment you publish. If you can publish a monthly indicator a week earlier, then it may have a double value for the users of statistics. And if you can double the value of statistics by using big data, then it is at least worthwhile trying. More timely statistics is actually about statistics that get published a little bit earlier. You can also have early indicators of what you're going to publish, and you can go as far as making nowcasts. You can also, of course, think about forecasts, but that is normally not in scope of official statistics, except maybe for population statistics. That's generally an exception, because no other institution is so well placed to give population forecasts as statistical offices. But nowcast becomes certainly possible in some cases for big data. I'll give you also an example later. And then, even if you don't do anything new with the data you get from new sources, you can you have just more information available, for instance, to compare your data with, your statistics with. So you can have a better look at its plausibility, or you can even integrate the big data in your statistical production process. And so you can improve quality. Then we get to a couple of subjects in which especially the management of statistical offices are very interested in, because that is because we're getting to the area of critical performance indicators. And so response burden is one of them. Now, if you can replace a traditional statistics by a statistic based on big data, then you don't have to bother businesses or households and persons. And so you can reduce the response burden. And if you do it to an extreme, then what we are trying to do in Statistics Netherlands as a long-term objective point on the horizon is to have zero footprint statistics. That is, people and businesses don't notice that anything has been done, not in the sense that we ask them to respond to data requests. However, it is important with zero footprint statistics to be completely transparent and to comply with all requirements of data confidentiality and data security and associated matters. But then, if you do that and you are outreaching to the public and really guarantee in spirit and in practice to what's required for confidentiality and other requirements, then zero footprint is really an ideal to pursue as a statistics office. And big data is the thing that may allow us to do that one day. Now, another thing that's important to society and to the management of statistical offices is cost reduction. It is also important to us as a taxpayer, so I don't want to present this as only a concern of managers of statistics. It is something in which I think whole society is interested in cost reduction and higher efficiency, and these objectives are closely connected to response burden reduction, because these aspects often go together, but quite often they have separate performance indicators. And so an office has to meet a target in terms of response burden, and also has to meet a target in terms of cost. But the way you reach this target is, for instance, by reducing or eliminating even a complete survey. And then this has this double effect. So these are the opportunities that we could keep in mind when talking about big data. And with this, I finish the first part. I'll now go to the international context. So what happened in the international context? At some places, it was recognized, so around 2013, that big data would become a strategic issue. In a positive sense for the opportunities, but also it was perceived by some offices as a threat. And so it was picked up, and as these things go, there's it's not really well planned which organization starts with dealing with a new phenomena. And in this case, it was the United Nations Economic Commission for Europe, the UNECE, which gave this definition, which I presented. And UNECE is based in Geneva, and they had already focused on modernization of statistics and on standardization within statistical processes and with all kind of architectures for data and for processes and for organizations and so on. And so UNECE started. Then after UNECE, United Nations found out at a higher level that big data existed. And so they formed groups and became active. And then already, actually in 2013 already, the European Union also became aware of this phenomenon. Only it is a little bit difficult to act quickly. Within the European Union, because they have more possibilities for legislation, for binding agreements, and so on. But then that also takes a little bit more time. So they recognized it early, but had a slow start. And it actually really started at the beginning of this year, that actual projects in big data were started. So now I give you an overview of these three levels. I should mention that there is much more going on. Time doesn't allow me to go into what OECD is doing, what IMF is doing, what the ECB, the European Central Bank, is doing on big data. Many countries are active. Many combinations of countries are active. Regional organizations are active. Associations of provinces and regions are active. So a lot is going on. The three levels I mentioned, I've been active in, and I'm still active in myself, so I could at least report from my own experiences. And I do think that these organizations did take the lead in this, and at least gave some references. So I will focus on that. So I will start with the UNECE. Excuse me. Walking through Victoria yesterday was very nice, but it was also raining, and so it has a little effect, I'm afraid. I'm sorry. So UNECE, big data activities in Geneva. By the way, UNECE has many more members than just European countries. former Soviet Union states, CIS countries, are member, and so are a couple of advanced nations, advanced in the sense of having advanced statistical systems, such as Canada and Australia. So it's quite wide, but they are all interested in modernization of statistics. So the UNECE gave a definition that you've seen, a classification of big data sources as well, as you will see. And in 2014, they started with work on partnerships, on privacy, and on quality. And so I was involved in all three of them. I was not involved in what they also did in that same year. They set up a sandbox. And what's a sandbox? A sandbox is a place where you can play with children, but in the sense of big data, it is a place in Ireland where they have high computing facilities, Hadoop installed, and you can have a subscription to the sandbox and then send data to Ireland or work on a remote with remote facilities and just try out what are the possibilities of both using big data and of using software. And so it's open to everyone, also to regional offices. You can just take, it's not very, very expensive. I think about €10,000 for a year. Of course, there's the difficulty when you put data in another country that you cannot just put confidential data there. But I'll give you an example where we put data there for research purposes. And then also what UNECE did together with UNSD, but they took the initiative in 2014, is to have a survey among NSIs, among National Statistical Institutes, the national level. So they sent the survey to a number of countries and collected data on projects that were going on in these countries with big data. I've put here a link, but as I mentioned, you will find links in the in the workbook. So, but this is the what the UNECE did. I will just, to give you a flavor, I will give you an overview of the types of big data sources that have been identified by the UNECE. It has three main categories. The first one is social networks, and it's based essentially from information that is generated by human beings. And so there are different categories within these social networks. And apart from human-sourced information in social networks, the second category is more traditional business systems. And so this is actually generated in the as a byproduct of processes that businesses are engaged in. And medical records, for instance, we all know, and commercial transactions. Actually, one of the most important big data sources is financial transaction data. And towards the end of the second part, I will give you an example of what's being done in America with credit card information. But normally it is very difficult to get this data available for statistical purposes. And in the Netherlands, we are now considering changing the law in order to get legal access to this data. And that is very interesting. In some cases, you have a difficulty with getting access, and you talk to the potential provider and they say, well, I would love to help you, but I'm not sure, I'm afraid that our customers will complain because of privacy, and we're also a little bit hesitant because it's not clear how to interpret the law in this case. And so they actually ask us to change the law. So they say then it's settled, and then we're both happy because we would like to help you, but we kind of feel we cannot do it right now. So these are, this is the second of the three categories. And the third one is the sensor data, mainly the Internet of Things. And I'll give this example of sensor data of road sensors. There are many categories, and I don't think that actually the list is complete, because this list is already 2 years old. And in a changing environment, this is too old already to be completely valid at a time. Actually, the UN itself has now started to have a look at the classification to in order to revise it and update it, and also to make it more flexible. And I started as a classification expert in 1984 in Statistics Netherlands, a long time, a very long time ago, in classifications, working on the NAES classification, or the Dutch version of that. And one of the first things I learned is that if you're not quite sure of what is in a classification, then at least add a category of not elsewhere classified. And that was omitted here. So I see at least one improvement for the classification of big data sources here. Now, at the level of the United Nations, there's a global working group on big data for official statistics. So I'm, as Christine mentioned, I'm a member of that. It started in 2014, and it had a number of task teams, and they worked in several areas. So I was a member of this management group, and I led the area of access and partnerships, and was a member of the cross-cutting issues. So if you have specific questions about that, you may ask me. Actually, classification is part of the cross-cutting issues. And what's also interesting, they collected information in 2015, so the year after UNECE started with data collection. They collected data from all 193 countries that are represented in the United Nations, and about half of them responded. And they asked, what do you do with big data, and in which areas do you apply it, and do you actually use it, or are you just doing research, or are you investigating the possibilities to start research? Do you have access to data? What kind of training needs do you have? And so there were many, many questions. And the results were interesting. So we got quite a few projects that were reported, and especially OECD countries replied to the questionnaire. So we do have information about important projects of rich countries. And so one of the interesting things is that although many countries are talking about going to use big data, they are not actually using it at a time. And there's also reference to this in the workbook. So what in what areas are countries active? Web scraping. I mentioned that many countries do that already. We did it before the term of big data. There's a session on web scraping, I think, on tourism later today. And so this is also being done here. Scanner data. I hesitate to include scanner data as in big data, but I think you can think it's business-generated data, so it's in the classification. So let's call this big data. Mobile phone. Data, we'll get an example. Social media data, an example later as well. Satellite imagery data. I will mention it a couple of times at special places during the presentation. And then there are many other areas where projects are going on. And so we now have a kind of an overview of what's going on at world level. And then I come to the European level. The ESS, for those who are not familiar with the statistical system, ESS is the European Statistical System. That is the name for what we do all together to get European statistics, to get statistics that are covered by regulations, and even our national and regional statistics should at least be coherent with this with this system. So the ESS, that is the set of all European activities on statistics. And for big data, the first step was taken at the end of 2013, and then the director generals, the CEOs of the National Statistical Institutes, came together in Scheveningen. And Scheveningen is a place in the Netherlands. So it was initiated by our director general. And they wrote down a memorandum on what to do with big data in the ESS, what to launch activities. And so they agreed that at the ESS level, a big data action plan and a roadmap big data should be drafted. And that was done. And one of the things, and it was in mind already from the beginning, one of the things that was done was the launch of a European program or project on big data. And since we are talking about the ESS, such a research project is called an ESS net of member states. And there are many ESS nets, and one of them now is the ESS net of big data, and this started on in February this year, and this is actually my main occupation right now because I'm leading this this SNET. I'll go through these three international aspects of the ESS one by one. The Scheveningen Memorandum actually identified the strategic issue of big data. And they also recognized that there are important privacy and data protection as issues involved in there. So they said this has to be taken with the activities taken into account from the beginning. You may have heard the term privacy by design. The earlier you take care of privacy in designing a process, then the better you can guarantee the privacy of individual information, privacy of individuals, and also businesses. Businesses also have a privacy concern, I can tell you. It also called for collaboration, so don't do it alone. It was recognized that you need certain skills, and of course, a methodology, there are many methodological issues, and that's very closely to quality. And there are also concerns on quality. And some statisticians have an attitude of saying the quality with big data is such a problem, let's be very careful and let's first take some more time to study this, and I think that is an honorable approach, but we still have to find ways to really get to the low-hanging fruit, because there is, I think, low-hanging fruit in big data. So if you see at such a discussion with director generals, there are some that really look from the perspectives of possibilities, opportunities, and others who are much more prudent. So there's a cultural dimension to this discussion, and I think that's very interesting, actually. And so the action plan and roadmap I mentioned, and these are the themes of the action plans. All the things I mentioned come back. Ethics is something closely related also to privacy. There are policy issues that have to do also with the strategic dimension. For the ESS, experience sharing is important. I think all these aspects will come, will pass at this presentation. And so I go to the SNET big data. This is actually, I think, maybe the biggest SNET that exists at the moment, because there are 22 partners of 20 countries, which makes it a little bit difficult to coordinate. But one of the objectives of this SNET is also to spread knowledge. And dissemination is one of the objectives also of this SNET. And so this was done in an administrative way, as it goes with SNETs. There's a framework partnership agreement, which states the intention of partners to work together on this, but there's no agreement on finances or who does what in a framework partnership agreement. That is worked out in specific grant agreements, or SGAs. And these specific grant agreements specify the amount of money to be awarded by Eurostat, and how much all each single partner gets, and what they have to do for that, and what the whole SNET has to produce with a time schedule. And so there are two phases for this SNET. One is mainly this year and the beginning of next year, and the second one starts at the beginning of next year and continues till mid-2018. And so you see there's a certain overlap between these two phases, and that has a special reason. That is, with big data, and generally speaking also with research, you are not quite sure what results you will get. And then you need to be flexible, and halfway it's better to evaluate and then start a second phase, then plan everything from the beginning, and then maybe get stuck. And now the interesting thing is that with certain areas we know we can go rather far. We know already that, for instance, with smart meters we can do a lot. And so this smart meter part of the SNET continues till July 2017. And then there are other areas, as mobile phone data use, where we don't even know whether we get access to the data. And so for such subjects, we said, well, rather stop it at the end of 2016, and then we know at least whether we get the data. And if the answer is yes, then, and the answer is yes, then we continue with this from January 2017 on. So you have certain areas where they continue into the next year, and certain areas where they start in the next year. So what are these, what are actually the areas of the SNET? So the main thing is to get practical experience, to really work with actual data. And there are a number of areas, and there are corresponding work packages in the SNET. And the first one is web scraping, and specifically there's a work package for job vacancies, web scraping in order to get data for to make statistics on jobs availability. And then there's also web scraping for getting enterprise characteristics. For instance, the activity of an enterprise. Nowadays, you use sometimes administrative sources, sometimes you use survey information. And if you can just get it on the from the web, because it's there already, then that would help. Smart meters is another one, which is a smart meter. Is something that you install at a household, and then on a continuous basis it transmits data to the provider, and this data gives you an idea of what's actually going on with energy consumption. And there are many applications, potential applications from that. Then the third is automatic identification system, or AIS. That is a following system of ships, and it's standardized throughout the world. So that's that could be very useful for transport statistics in which ships are involved. It also includes ships on national waterways within the country, the rivers and so on. Mobile phone data is a very promising one. It could be one day a very important data source for statistics. And the work package of mobile phone data is led by David Salgado of INE in Spain. And so Spain is very much involved in this. Unfortunately, Telefonica was thought of as a data source, but we did not succeed in getting data from that source. But there are other countries, that, such as Belgium, Proximus, that has access to mobile phone data. And then there are two work packages, two areas where multiple inputs, multiple sources are being combined. And these are not necessarily all big data sources, but of course there should be at least one big data source involved. Otherwise, you would not put it into this research effort. And one is especially concerned with short-term indicators, the nowcasting, and another is involved with tourism, with population statistics, and also with mobility. So how do you tackle such a research? Well, one thing is to just look at the different phases of a statistical process. You start with the input side. Now, normally, if you work according to an enterprise architecture in statistics, you first start defining the desired output, and then from there you reason back to what inputs you need. In this case, with big data, it is something different. We are going to look at the potential of different big data sources, but also having in mind certain vaguely described outputs. So we start with data access. We have started with data access. We started in February. After the access, you have to do data handling. And then you really have, when you have got the data in the office in a way that you can use it, then you have a number of methodological questions to solve and technological questions to solve. You just have to organize the processing. And from that, you can get to output. There's actually a feedback loop between these all these phases. And apart from these first four phases, the SNET also looks at the future. Now, when you've got the overview of, for instance, smart meter data possibilities, what should you recommend for the European system of statistics? And where should we put our effort after 2018. Already it's envisaged that when this SNET ends in mid-2018, that there will probably be another SNET launched to pick up where this SNET has led to, and probably with completely different types of pilots. So this is the subdivision of each of these pilots. Just to give you an idea of what's going on in these pilots, just a couple of aspects. One thing is, for instance, that you have population questions. And for instance, for job vacancies, you do have the possibility to do some web scraping and get data on jobs from the web. But then you can get it from enterprises themselves, but you can also get it from companies that do it for the enterprise, or even job portals where they collect lots of jobs. And then of course you have questions of over coverage and under coverage. So this is one of the things that is investigated in this research. Another example is for web scraping for enterprise characteristics, we need URLs, so the web web addresses of businesses. And in order to get that, you need also to have a sampling frame. And then you have to process and do a number of checks. And here you see what kind of tools are used by ISTAT, the Italian statistical agency. Another example is smart meters. This is led by Estonia, and they have good data available. And then the first thing they did is have a look at what data do we actually have and what's the problem. So they have the metering data, but these metering data refer to certain points, and there are issues associated with getting these points, because these points are sometimes a whole, institution or an old people's home or whatever. So you have the metering points, and there are contracts behind the provision of energy, and this contract information is then also needed. And sometimes you see that the contractor does not live on the place where the energy is delivered, and so you have to deal with those kind of things. And then of course you would like to know something about the user of the data, of the energy, I should say. And so these are the a number of aspects that are investigated. Now this is the AIS data, the following system for ships, and I find this very interesting. This is what they made early on. Just they got the data from a private provider who collected the data, and for a very small fee they made this data available for this SNET. And then we looked at this data and we saw that there are some funny things going on. Now I mentioned already that there are also internal waterways on the continent, for instance. And so you see that there's some ships going on. Of course, all orange colors represent ships. And you see also ships on the ocean. That's also clear. You also see that there's a boundary of where you receive you receive the information where the ships are, and then somewhere on the ocean you lose track. But you also see a very funny thing, and that is that there seems to be a number of ships in the Sahara. And that's these kind of things you really see when you work with a new data source, especially with a big data source, where there are not many mechanisms to guarantee quality, and you can encounter these kind of things, and then you have to deal with them, talk with the provider, and then there seems to be, for instance, just a processing error, and they never knew that they had ships in the Sahara, but then they are aware of it by then, and so we can help each other. But so never trust the data as statisticians. I should not tell you. You know, if you are well aware of that, of course. So this is a source. And another example is this led by Poland, where they try to combine traditional sources of administrative data and of surveys with big data for three domains: population and tourism, and the right one is agriculture. Now, finishing the chapter of the presentation on international developments, I should mention one thing, and that is the SDG indicators. SDG are the Sustainable Development Goals. I think even if you're not a statistician, you must have heard of it by reading newspapers. These were agreed on by the United Nations, and these are the targets on which the world agrees. Now, people may be a little bit skeptical about the Sustainable Development Goals, but in the past with the Millennium Goals, it was actually a mechanism that was really effective. Not that all Millennium Goals were met, but still it got a number of countries really moving into the right direction, and the thought is that with Sustainable Development Goals, that will happen as well. Now, why do I mention this with big data? There are a number of indicators that are requested to be produced by at least at the country level. And so we have 17 goals, and for each of these goals a number of targets have been defined. And in the end, these targets are measured by in total 230 indicators. And so we have to produce those indicators. And for about a third of these indicators, we have a big problem. We just don't have data. And so we have all our statistical program. And I must say, a third of the indicators, this is data we have from Statistics Netherlands. So we made an analysis of what we've got. And we even published at the beginning of this month already the first overview of what we've got. But for about a third of the indicators, we just don't have official statistics right now. And Statistics Netherlands is not a developing statistical institute. So you can imagine that in other countries, developing countries especially, the problem is bigger. And if you don't have the data, and you request it to get the data, and you have little money, and in many cases you don't have appropriate sources, then, of course, the question is, could you then maybe use big data for that? And this is also an opportunity, because, of course, if you have to provide new data, new statistics, then you've got a problem, because it costs money, it costs resources, and maybe you don't have them. But then, this is a requirement at world level, at government level. Governments have committed themselves to produce these data. And so there is a case, as we are doing in the Netherlands, to ask for some more government money to at least start data collection for this. So as a start, we got from Foreign Affairs our first data scientist financed to get data for SDGs. And then, of course, there's also the World Bank that tries to get this going and has very good connections with the with developing countries. And for advanced institutes, there's also opportunity to help those countries and to export the knowledge paid by the World Bank. So this is something that is also helps creating a context of opportunities. It's not only requirements for the Statistics Bureau, it's also something that really may help us. So that was enough on the international, and now it gets interesting, I hope. I will talk about examples, and the first example is on road sensor data. So what is it about? In the Netherlands, we have on our streets, we have measurement points, road sensors. We call them traffic loops because the sensor has they are in the street and they have a loop that works with induction. And so we have now more than 60,000 of those loops. So 60,000 points on the road network in the Netherlands where we measure how many vehicles pass, and we do that every minute. And we also make a distinction between the lengths of cars in three classes. And this makes for more than 230 million records a day. And now this is an interesting source, and we started working with this source because it was easy to work with, or at least to start working with, to do research on. Because the data come from a national data warehouse for traffic information. It's part of the national government, and by law, we have access to the data. And also, we don't identify the vehicles, so there's not any privacy issue involved. So this is a good source to start working with real big data, with 230 million records with lots of data, also metadata a day. And this is the road network of the main roads. And if you look at the top, on the left, there's the North Sea, and then there's an inner sea through which there's a dike, and there's a road going over that dike. So there are also road sensors on that dike. And here you see it in red, this dike. And so when you start with investigating a data source, it's good just to start investigating the data. And if you have a measurement grid, just to look at one or two of those measurement points or a set of measurement points, especially measurement points where you have very limited conditions, very specific conditions. And now with a dike, normally when you enter a dike by car, you always leave the dike by car. You don't go to the left or the right or something goes wrong. And so there's a very strict relationship between what's going in and goes out from a dike. So that's a very good starting position for research. And so there are already quite a number of road sensors on the dike. And so we could look at those. And if you look at one sensor, then this is the pattern. Each square depicts one day. And on a line, you will see 14 days, 2 weeks, and then the second line has another 2 weeks, and so on. And so this is done for 196 days for one sensor. And this is really a typical sensor. This is something that you will see these kind of patterns with many, many sensors. Now, first of all, you see a distinction between working days and weekdays. So the pattern is different. So in weekdays, you have a morning peak, and in the weekend, not. You have somewhat on the left two columns, for instance, you have only a gradual peak during the day. What you also see is that there are a couple of days where we didn't receive any data, and there are a couple of days where actually, apparently, we received wrong data. There was something wrong with the sensor, and this is typical for the new situation we get in with sensors. Sensors work or don't work or have an error, and somehow in statistics you have to deal with that. If you work with an administrative register, you try to get the quality right and then you start doing the analysis. With big data, you first really have to work on the on your inputs. And these are then for five sensors the pattern. Of course, these patterns are correlated, the data are correlated, and you can use that, and you can also use that to improve the metadata of your input. Now, these are the measurement points where two roads cross, and so you see there are also measurement points not on the road, on the main road itself, and you also have to deal with this when you select the measuring points in your statistics. Now, this is what we got when we put all the 60,000 patterns on top of each other and then normalize it, that the peak gets to 1.0. And then you see there's a morning peak and there's an afternoon peak, but it differs according to the size of the vehicle. And so small vehicles, just the car with which I go to work, has a morning peak and then afternoon peak. And let's look at the green, the large vehicles. That's interesting, and we didn't know that before. They tend to have a break when I go to work, because otherwise they work less efficient. So they plan their morning break when there's a peak of private cars. And this kind of analysis shows that with big data. So that's interesting. Now, we use this to make a statistics on traffic intensity, and we published this last year, 2015, and we published data on 2014 and 2013, making a comparison. And these were the results of the top five motorways. And what's interesting with big data, once you've done this, you get many more opportunities, more possibilities. So at the beginning of this year, 2016, we had extreme frost in the north of the country. And normally we don't have frost to such an extent that you cannot get on the road. But in the north, it was terrible at the beginning of the year, especially the first three working days. And so we thought when that happened, hey, we have these road sensor data. Can we do something with it? And so within 1 week for these six roads, we had a press release. The 8th of January, we had a press release on the use of the roads in the north of the country of the three first working days of the year, of this year. And so we made a press release. We are very proud of that, of course, because I think we had never made a new statistic so quickly. And big data has made that possible. And it's good quality statistics. And so here you see that it's more or less halved the use of the road. It's also connected to policy, because there was the government asked people not to make use of the road, actually, for safety reasons. And so still half of them did that. And there was one road in the very north that was hardly used. It was really not usable. So road sensor data. Now, the good thing is that privacy and data acquisition, data access was not really a problem, but there were issues on methodology, on what you get and what you don't get, selectivity, on quality, as we've seen, on processing. We had to find out how to arrange the statistical process. We needed some specific skills. And also, we did research on this, and we are now making regular statistics. And we encountered the problem that it's very difficult to go from the research phase to the regular statistical phase. It takes a lot of time and acceptance and effort and training. And so that was really an issue in our case. It's also something not only for big data, but general when institutions have innovative products to get into regular production is very difficult. So second example is mobile phone data. And this can be used for following the population during the day or to make mobility statistics. Tourism has been used. There are actually many, many other uses, like looking at economic activity, to give an example. But there are many possibilities to use mobile phone data. And it's a good source if you can get access, because everyone nowadays has a mobile device. And there's issues associated with them, because they're not always on. You can give them to your children. You may have several mobile phones, etc. But still, you have good coverage, and at least in the Netherlands, there are a good grid of antennas. When you're in a country with large part with sparse population, that still may be a problem. And we use data of a single mobile data company, and we got our aggregates. And we didn't want to get into problems with confidentiality, so we had have a threshold for each cell of 15 events, and we even don't get the individual data. We gave the algorithm to the company, and they ran it through their database, and we did some quality analysis, and then finally we got results. That is research results. We have not made regular statistics with them. And now this is the result, or at least a result. What you see is the map of the Netherlands, and in yellow, that is the normal situation where people are registered for the registration of the population at municipality level. And now if there at a certain moment, this is one day, if at a certain moment there are more people in a municipality than there are registered, then the color becomes red. And if there are less people, then the color becomes green. And so what you see at the middle, there is Amsterdam. Let's see whether I can. There it is. So there's Amsterdam. And so you see that people go to Amsterdam. Even at night, there are still people, extra people in Amsterdam, more than they're registered. And there you see from what areas the people come to work in Amsterdam. And that goes for many cities. And so this is very revealing. You know what are the sleeping cities and where are the working cities. And this is for many purposes, policy purposes also, this is very, very useful. You also see that visualization is important. This really helps to, if you have such a result of research, and you go to, for instance, the Ministry of Internal Affairs and say, hey, are you interested in knowing where people are when there are calamities, when there are events, big events organized? Or are you interested, Ministry of Transport, in where people live and go to and whether there are alternatives and so on? You can also go into more detail on this map. Then you can get finances from ministries to make such statistics. And in that sense, again, big data provides an opportunity, provided you get access to this data. And this has proven to be a very difficult affair for mobile phone data. So issues are privacy, obviously, data acquisition, I mentioned, methodological difficulties. Representativeness, so how does it relate to the target population? Selectivity is just a plain question. By what mechanism do you get the data? What do you get without having a target population in mind yet? Quality issues, infrastructure for the statistical office, I mean, skills needed. So there are a number of issues. Now I've got a couple of minutes for the last example, but I'll come back to that later. Social media data. Now we can use this data maybe for measuring sentiment. And we already produce a confidence, consumer confidence index on the basis of a traditional survey. But there are other possible uses like social coherence indices. It's on our work plan right now. Other uses like looking at economic activity. And social media are used very much in the Netherlands, relatively also to other countries. I think Iceland is number one in Europe and Netherlands number two. But if you look at Spain, then there's a region in the north, close to the Gulf of Biscaya. And that region also has quite a good coverage. So I think there are some possibilities as well. So we use all media messages that are written in Dutch and that are public. So then it's less of a problem of privacy. There is still a problem of the question, may we still use it because it was published for other purposes, but still. We use it, but we don't collect the data because it would take several employees to do that on a continuous basis. So we buy the data for a very small amount from a company called Cousteau, and they already provide a sentiment to each record, to each message. And so we get a data set of more than 3.5 billion messages. And we did some analysis on that. And I should mention that this was mainly done by Piet Daas and Marco Patz. You will see, for all these examples, you will see a number of references in the work, in the workbook. And so we asked ourselves the question, can we actually replace the consumer confidence survey by this source? and at the same time maybe even reduce the production time, because getting data electronically goes much further than sending a questionnaire and then processing it. And so we actually Cousteau used a certain way of determining the sentiment. I'll skip this because of time. And you can also look at the different platforms. And now most messages are from Facebook and from Twitter, especially Twitter. Now if you look at the pattern for Facebook and Twitter, then let's have a comparison to the with the Consumer Confidence Index, and it will appear in the corner. There it is. And you see there are some similarities. And so what we see right away is that we may consider whether big data from Facebook and Twitter, the others are not so good, could be used to replace at least part of the response of the for the survey. So we did quite some investigation. And these are the, at the top again, the consumer confidence. The green is on the daily basis, and then the red spots are on a weekly basis, and the black spots are the monthly averages. And so you see the pattern is quite good. And so as a result, we did get a high correlation. And so we also looked at the time pattern. The survey precedes the confidence of Twitter and of Facebook. But still, since we take a couple of weeks to process or to collect the data by survey, we think we can still shorten the time to market if we use this source. And we can also do it on a weekly basis. So we have a couple of targets together right away. But then, of course, what are we actually measuring? It's a kind of correlation. Is it really a causation that is involved there? I come back to that after the after intermission, just two slides. We can also use this source for making a general sentiment indicator as a kind of standalone. This research result that would be interesting on its own. And the issues we encountered, not so much privacy and data acquisition, public data after all, but there are methodological issues, not only selectivity, but also in this case, the meaning of the data, what does the sentiment actually measure, and the validity of the methods, because you're actually modeling, and this model, is it valid? This had to really be validated, and that's a difficult question, and again, skills. So this is why I leave for the presentation before coffee. I'm sorry that I'm 3 minutes late, but I hope you enjoy your coffee, and we'll be back at 11:30, and then I'll go through these subjects from a different angle, not example by example, but issue by issue. Thank you for your attention.
Bueno, ba orain atzedenaldia izango dugu ordu erdik kafe hartzeko nahi baduzue, eta hori izango da Mirador aretoan, hemen harrerako bidean dago, eta nik uste dut norbaitek gidatu gaituela. Mila esker. Bueno, como decíamos, pues hay un descanso de media hora, como decía Peter, y tomaremos